Chapter 6, Different Cooling Concepts for Traction Motors. In this chapter we will hear about air and liquid cooling, about self-enforced ventilated motors, and about open and encapsulated motors. For a traction motor in the railway sector, different cooling concepts can be used. It's up to the system designer which cooling concept he chooses for the motor and which he thinks it is best for this application. The first decision is whether you want to use a liquid-cooled motor or an air-cooled machine. And for the air-cooled machine, you have to decide if you want to use an open design, which you can, for example, see here, where the cooling air goes through the whole machine, or if you want to use an encapsulated design, where parts of the machine are encapsulated and are therefore not in touch with the air which comes from the outside. So the area where the motor is encapsulated is marked in red, while the area where the cooling air comes from the outside is marked in blue. You can also decide where the fan or the blower is situated. It can be outside the motor, so somewhere in the vehicle, or the fan can be integrated within the motor in different concepts. The first cooling concept what we are going to talk about is the air-cooled open design with forced ventilation. So that means that there is a blower or fan somewhere in the vehicle, and there are ducts which guide the air to the motor. And then in the motor itself, the air goes through the stator lamination, which is here in green, and it also goes through the rotor, which is marked here in pink color, and it also cools the winding heads, which can be seen here in orange, and also the short circuit rings here also in orange. The first advantage with this design is that you can get very high airflow, so you can put a strong blower inside the locomotive or inside the train set to cool the machine. Also, what is a big benefit is that you can directly cool all the parts of the machine, and especially the rotor, which is otherwise critical to cool when you look later at the encapsulated designs, and also the winding heads, where you have a big area which you can use to get the heat away. It's also a big advantage of this concept that the cooling, so the airflow, is largely independent of the actual motor speed. So that means especially that at low speed of the motor you can still cool efficiently as well as in standstill. So even when the motor is not rotating, you can still cool the motor and get the heat away. Another advantage is that you can control the speed of the fan according to the actual motor temperature. So if you have a temperature sensor within the motor and you see that your motor is quite cold, then you just lower the speed of the fan, and then you have a lower energy consumption and also lower noise. And so this concept also leads to a very high efficiency of the motor itself. On the one hand, because it doesn't have a fan in the motor, and on the other hand, you can also control the ventilation as you like. For example, if you want to keep the winding cool and therefore lower the copper losses, then you get highest efficiency out of the motor. And this motor concept and cooling concept is also especially suitable for low operating speed, because if you, for example, think about the shunting locomotive or also a rack locomotive, then when you're operating for a long time at a low speed, you can still cool the motor in a very efficient way. Of course, there's also a disadvantage with this motor concept, and it's that you have to install an external blower somewhere in your vehicle, and you also need air ducts from this blower to the motor. But still, this is a very attractive cooling concept, and it's used in lots of applications, especially also in high power applications. And as already said before, also when you want to control, for example, the fan speed to lower the noise in some situations. So an example is the Stadler EMU Flirt, where open forced ventilated motors are used. Also in the UK, at the Metro Merseyrail in Liverpool. And it's also quite common to use them in high-speed trains, for example, for the new Avril trains for Renfe. As already mentioned, this cooling system is also especially attractive if you operate lots of the time with low operating speed of the vehicle. So, for example, it is used for this shunting loco, what you see here. This cooling concept is also used for a rack locomotive. For example, this is the most powerful rack locomotive in the world, operating in Brazil. And there it is used for two different kind of motors. One is the motor who drives the cogwheel, and the other motor drives the normal adhesion wheels. On the contrary, you can decide to attach the fan directly to the shaft of the motor and place the fan within the motor. So then the fan is mounted directly on the shaft, and no additional installations are required in the vehicle. So this is a very simple cooling concept. Not only cooling concept, but also motor concept, because you don't need any cooling ducts from the vehicle to the bogie. An advantage of this open self-ventilated cooling concept is that, again, you have a good cooling of the stator, of the rotor, and also of the winding heads of the machine. But it also has some disadvantages. And first disadvantage is that the fan is directly attached to the shaft, so it also rotates with the same speed than the shaft. And at high speed, you also get lots of noise from the machine. And on the other hand, when the machine is rotating at a slow speed, or even at standstill, then you have very poor cooling or no cooling at all. This concept is also an open machine, so every part of the machine gets fresh air from the outside, but in contrast to the first option, where you have the air inlet somewhere in the vehicle, here the air inlet is directly in the bogie, and so it's possible that water comes inside, that dust goes inside, and so very often, therefore, you use filters, but these filters then require maintenance. There is another disadvantage, because when the fan rotates with the same speed as the shaft, then at high speed, you have a high rotational speed of the fan and therefore also high windage losses. As already mentioned before, it's up to the system designer to choose the cooling concept of the motor. So you can find Metro vehicles either with one concept or another concept. In this case, you see the self-ventilated open machine used for a Metro. And here in the picture, you can see the filters. This cooling concept can as well be used for EMUs. So here this is a CAF vehicle, the CVT UK. Here you can see another application. And in this case, the cooling concept is used at the generator. So the high-speed train class 800-802 for UK, they use diesel generator power packs to supply the train with energy when you cannot get energy from the overhead line, and the generator is equipped with self-ventilated open cooling, air cooling. There are also many cases where you want to protect the inside of the motor from, for example, from dirt or from water. And then the whole inside, you can see here, is encapsulated. And so especially the winding is protected, but also the cooling ducts here in the stator lamination and here in the rotor lamination, they keep open and cannot be fulfilled with dirt. In this concept, the fan is mostly mounted on the shaft, so there are no additional installations required in the vehicle. Also, usually you don't use any filters, because the inside of the motor is already protected by the encapsulation. There's one big disadvantage of this concept, and it's the encapsulation itself. Because if you encapsulate most of the parts of the machine, then it's also difficult to get the losses out of the machine. So lots of heat is produced in the windings and also in the rotor bars, in the short circuit rings, and somewhere you have to get rid of these losses and of this energy. And in this case, it's not directly, but you first transport the heat to the outside of the lamination, and then the outside of the lamination is cooled by the air which comes from the outside. And as the fan is mostly mounted directly on the shaft with this cooling concept, you have high fan noise at high speed, and so the maximum motor speed is limited due to the noise. Also at standstill you have poor cooling, and this is also valid for low speed, where you have low rotational speed of the fan. This cooling concept is, for example, used in a very popular tram platform. It's the Urbos platform by CAF. And you can see that these motors have a rated power of only 70 kilowatt for a single motor. Such a cooling concept is also used for a light rail vehicle in Manchester, UK. There is also a special form of this cooling concept where you don't use any fan at all. So you still use an encapsulated design, but you use only natural cooling on the outside. And of course, it doesn't need any additional installations. So it's very easy concept. And because it's encapsulated, no dirt and water can come inside. And also the windings are protected. It also uses no filters, and you have no fan noise because there is no fan. But of course there is a very big disadvantage, because with this concept the cooling works quite poorly and you get a very low power out of this machine. So the power density compared to other machine designs is really low. And especially at low speed or standstill, you have nearly no cooling at all. There are two vehicles where this cooling concept is used. For example, you can see here the tram in Vienna. It's a ultra low floor tram. And in first stage it was liquid cooled, but later it was decided to use another cooling concept because there was not enough space anymore for the liquid cooling. And so this special air-cooled machine is used with convection cooling. And as you can see, the power is very low for the air-cooled machine. For the liquid-cooled machine it was 80 kilowatts, and for the air-cooled machine it's only 52 kilowatts. This cooling concept is also used for a very special vehicle on a special railway in Germany. It's the Wuppertaler Schwebebahn. And as you can see, in this concept, only the surface of the motor is cooled by outside air. Another option is the liquid cooling. While the liquid cooling is really popular recently with road vehicles, It is used not so often with the railway vehicles and its motors. But liquid cooling is a very attractive cooling concept, especially because of its low noise level. So the motor doesn't have any fan on the outside, so the motor with liquid cooling is really quiet. It's also always encapsulated, so no dirt and no water can come inside the machine, and the winding is protected. And by the liquid cooling, the motor is also cooled at standstill. And as there is no filter and nothing else, so the motor is encapsulated, cannot become dirty, it has very low maintenance of the motor. Of course, there are also some disadvantages, and in the first place is the additional installations which are needed. You need a heat exchanger, you need pipes and pumps to supply the motor with the cooling liquid. And also the power density of the motor is limited because it is an encapsulated design, and in this case even without any inner cooling circle. Such cooling concept is for example used for the new vehicles of the Vienna tramway, and also in the UK it's used for the new Stadler vehicles for Metro Glasgow. If you use this cooling concept with liquid cooling for a permanent magnet machine, you must be sure that the rotor, which contains the permanent magnets, is also cooled appropriately. And you can ensure this by an additional inner cooling circle. So you have a fan inside the encapsulated part of the machine, which guides the inner air from the rotor to the stator lamination, where it is cooled by the liquid, by the cooling liquid. For example, this cooling concept is used for the permanent magnet generators in the Bombardier diesel-electric multi-engine locomotive. A few words about the design of the cooling system. First input is your duty cycle. You usually get it from the customer, and it gives you velocity and driving force over time. And then you take the machine design, so the geometry and also the electrical model, and you make an electrical simulation, and as a result you get the losses for different operating points. With these losses, you go into the thermal model, and input for the thermal model are the geometry of the machine and the losses over time, and as a result you get the temperatures over time for the whole driving cycle. The thermal calculation is usually a multiphysics problem, so you need the exact geometry. You build up a thermal network. You also have to take into account the harmonic losses, which are a result of the operation on the inverter, so the influence of the power electronics, and very often you also make CFD calculations as well to get information about the actual airflow. So as you could see, you can choose between different cooling systems. All of them have their advantages and disadvantages, and you can choose the most appropriate one for your application. So you can choose if you either want to use an air-cooled machine or a liquid-cooled machine. You can choose if you want an open or an encapsulated design, or if you want to use a self-ventilated or a forced-ventilated machine.